Alright, yeah. You can leave that there.
In the aggregation. Let me see.
Chapter 63. Okay, what motivated this? I just gotta repeat, just for the record. Block history.
Yeah, okay.
I got on the keys. You know, not really trying to impress no one or anything like that, but just trying to actually.
Oh, the drumming.
The drumming. When they were drumming, and you, Sister Emmanuel, was rehearsing. Was it the Book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, or is it a poem?
It was a poem. It was
the chapter Deuteronomy 28 never got recited. Passage. It never got, but the poem, the middle passage.
Uh-huh.
So, the eye, Sister, and said that. The keys reminded of the Eye of Bells.
Yeah.
So because of the middle passage across the Ethiopic Ocean, which if we base ourselves on the claims of the Kebra Negesht, it's rightfully the Ethiopian Ocean, in that all lands west to the sunset are proclaimed and given by law, by promulgation, to the King of Kings of Ethiopia, which is a whole different subject matter in and of itself. But there was a transportation, say, that occurred, in which through vessels Hebrew Israelites were transported to a strange land that they knew not.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just trying to bring that up to emphasize the fact that when you, Sister, expressed the bells being as like in the boats,
yeah,
I'm seeing like it's dark, and then all of a sudden light starts to appear, and you see rocks and large bodies of water like smashing across them, up on them.
Yes.
I gave this kind of like scenario to give light to the fact that you're recognizing, probably woke up or whatever the situation might have been, but you're realizing that you're in the ocean.
Yes.
And you hear the same bells that Sister Emmanuel was talking about when I was playing the keyboard or the piano.
Wow.
While she's reciting the middle passage. Mm-hmm. And what I think, how the tables have turned. There came a point in time in history when the Hebrew Israelite had to, either he was taking off or arriving. Mm-hmm. And as unfortunate as the circumstance may have been, it was indeed for our own exhortation, teaching, our own Torah, our own living instruction of how to get corrected by a rod that was... a discipline that was left off to the Goyim, to the Gentile, in saying that, okay,
what a strong punishment.
You don't want to be obedient to me, I'll send you a plague.
It's like the police.
That will have no pity on you.
Exactly.
And until that great day of Jubilee, where I declare you free once more, and it's fulfilled in His Majesty, pleading for us, the poor people of the world, and exalting the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of our God, of our Lord, Jesus Christos. Mm-hmm. That right there, League of Nations, Geneva, Switzerland, Nineveh for Jonah was the whole transparency, the whole transmitting of that ancient scripture into modern prophecy revealed, in that His Majesty transferred Him having the King of Kingship of Ethiopia before all the leaders of the world. He's saying, of all the governments,
mm-hmm.
of all the forms of civilization, there is none superior but the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christus. That means He gave to Jesus Christus his
kingdom.
His kingdom, and exalted the kingdom of the heavens superior to any other upon earth, declaring that we are all equal was the lesson.
Mm-hmm.
That the curse was over.
Exactly. We're reasoning.
For 500 years, the European was able to do to the indigenous type or the black type as he pleased, with no repercussion. With no repercussion. No cause and effect pattern. Hey, we can do with these people, these savage people, un-Catholic and un-white people, we could do with them as we please, and it seems like they're cursed. Like they don't, like there's not a punishment for it.
Mm-hmm.
That changed when His Majesty said, today it'll be us and tomorrow it'll be you. Mm-hmm. White Europeans for so long generations had not had that experience. No, you do to black people as you please and nothing happens.
Exactly.
Because they were no longer under the protection of Hashem.
Exactly.
Of the name. They were kind of like unnamed. So they were not elected at that period of time. Not that they were forsaken, but that they were in detention mode.
Exactly. And what
so
happened,
we are in detention mode. Excuse us.
Exactly. Okay, and then I'll mention something in the apocryphal text about Christ said that, you know, those who he handed some, remember, some of his flock, these shepherds, these other shepherds, some of them went too far while they had us in custody, too far.
Yeah, some of them went too far.
Mm-hmm.
So that's also a very fundamental building block on this Zion building,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
in spirit and in truth.
Mm-hmm.
First, the work must be initiated, and founded and grounded on spiritual principles, says mm-hmm. His Majesty.
Exactly.
Now, I was kind of losing track about the shepherds that went overboard. So
mm-hmm.
that's why His Majesty says, no doubt we need help.
Mm-hmm.
Don't
mm-hmm.
be ashamed. Don't ever be ashamed that we, as black people, as poor people, that we have to receive help from others. Because even though it is our responsibility, why, through disobedience, why we have come to this state,
mm-hmm.
it was not completely on our behalf alone that we are in the situation, because of some of these shepherds
mm-hmm.
that went out of line. So no doubt we have ourselves in a situation in which we will have to, we will have to receive aid.
Exactly.
We will have to receive aid, but if we depend on aid alone, I here testify that His Majesty gives us light to this parable. What if?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if we alone depend only on aid, then we would only further perpetuate our dependency,
mm-hmm.
which is contrary to independence. So there's a fine line to be drawn from receiving help, but help that is not attached to strings.
Exactly.
Pure and honest loving
exactly.
help. So now going forward to the whole the ships, what I now was trying to say is that I see how the tables have turned.
Mm-hmm.
From having a Hebrew Israelite look out the docks of the ships, perhaps maybe arriving at even the puerto at Veracruz in Mexico.
Wow.
Or arriving in the Caribbean, perhaps arriving later throughout the years in North America,
mm-hmm.
the modern day America. Well, I kind of see how the opposite end of that, Destruction Day, the Day of Vengeance.
Yes.
So Normandy Beach, this Day of Destruction. That's what they called it, D-Day. They were preparing
wow.
for D-Day. It was
see,
one of the most.
Tell us, they don't tell that. To
it was know. One of the most. Listen, it was one of the most. It changed everything. Everyone got together and they did their best planning to infiltrate already controlled German Europe.
It was like do
and
or die.
Find, yeah, we're gonna do everything we can. We're gonna hit them where it hurts. It's so much so that the 101st Airborne Division,
101.
Yeah, it was they're very recognized and very successful at what they did. First, before the attack of Destruction Day, they were sent out prior to before the attack. Lots of
mm-hmm.
as a campaign to weaken the inner forces, perhaps
wow.
even go forward, march forward onto the coast, the sea coast themselves, and from behind weaken
mm-hmm.
the defense
mm-hmm.
because
infiltrate.
Yeah, because that land was already taken up by Germany. They
mm-hmm.
had to assault amphibiously. They had to come from the water,
wow.
like
yeah.
a monster coming from the water, and step on land too.
Because Germany was protected. Because
the land, mm-hmm. but they had sent the 101st Airborne Division to infiltrate and to weaken. So this was a big project, a very big project. And now when it came to pass, I see, instead of Hebrew Israelites, the ones that bought into the American, or because of necessity, judge each individual why they were there.
Mm-hmm.
He knows each soul, and he gives each soul as the soul requires for its growth. You know,
exactly.
I trust that's accurate.
Uh-huh.
So now, you know, whoever participated, they saw the actual, now they're in boats. But it's a little bit different. Now they're in boats and they got guns.
Wow.
And I can hear maybe some tingling keys in the vibration of the
wow.
air. It's foggy. It's Normandy. It's Europe. It's a little bit cold. And here comes thousands of ships. Well, you know, maybe not thousands of big ships, but hundreds of huge ships. And
coming
then with thousands
port.
Of smaller vessels, you know,
wow.
coming or being unloaded from the giant ships. Preparing this assault, massive
exactly.
assault.
Exactly.
They were lucky that they landed on beaches that Hitler did not think that were going to be the ones landed on.
Wow.
So the resistance was
a blessing. For the
was
whole
a
side.
Blessing, but it was still
fire.
A destruction day. Because just like us Hebrew Israelites, when they opened up the gates and then they pulled us out and then off to work, this time the opening of those ship gates was an array of bullets.
Yeah.
A rain of just machine gun fire, like most of the people, as soon as they open the door, a lot of people, the ones in front, soldiers that are supposed to like somehow like swim ashore a little bit, even though they're not like off boarding or getting off board the ship like in the deep, right? Mm-hmm. But still, it's still not a very comfortable position to get off of a boat and expect to walk through water a little bit.
Cold water too, but then you get
while you're getting shot, because the Germans are all set up along the beach just shooting.
Here's the thing: it's kind of like not only Destruction Day, but almost like, you know, if one's believing that reincarnation or some or family curses, it's like the family or the old people from the old country, their great 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 grandchildren are sacrificed to go back for this World War II.
So
they're just like, because of all the drama they did for 400 years.
Well, everything is,
and on the German side too,
todo cae por su propio peso. That's all I gotta say. Everything lands, everything falls according to its own measure, according to its own weight. And mm-hmm. John knows the weights of each individual. He readeth the heart and knoweth the heart inside out.
Exactly.
You know, what can discern the innermost of a man but the spirit that comes from a man? So John knows all things.
Exactly. But just thinking the fear, oh my gosh.
The difference, you know, we got arrayed with the splash of machine gun fire of bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
Spitting machine gun lies.
Oh wow.
But it was our disobedience. We had to be disconnected from that which was we were connected to, which was not good.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why we were in the situation we were in.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If we were connected to something good, then we would have no need to, you know, to leave the land and be disconnected to another land and then forget about our bad ways and be called again when we can't take it no more. When we calling out of Egypt, like, okay, I can't take this no more. I don't like this life. Please. Hashem.
Yes.
You know? Anyway, so as Anna was saying,
take it no more.
His Majesty does proclaim that ultimate year of the Jubilee, and that he defends, he is speaking the very words of God that have been in the Bible since long time. But God is expressing them through the very mouth of man.
Of course, how else
made,
do it?
Made and created in his own image. Well, you know, I'm just putting that out there. Now, before I continue with the destruction day and go into the scripture and all that.
No, I'm just saying, how else are you going to do it? The way they have us on some other fanciful, other lies, like you said, bullet guns and lies.
Well, you know, His Majesty in the autobiography said this. I'm giving you bullets to attack the enemy. Don't discharge at random. Be very careful not to throw them away, and definitely don't sell them. It was becoming a problem. People were losing hope. People were losing hope. Hey, make some money off of some bullets. Maybe run away. I don't know. I'm not speculating that.
Exactly.
But it was definitely a possibility. Hey, you got a mean green fighting machine, you know, like the Italians with all this modern weaponry that you've never even seen. You super scared that you've never even seen vehicles.
That's definitely Star Wars right there.
Yeah, I know it's Star Wars.
That's where Lucas got it from. It had to.
That's where he got it. You listen, YouTube His Majesty videos.
It looks and like YouTube, the desert and the white. And
I'll tell you this video very
Jedi,
clearly.
Return of the Jedi.
Well, that's the one that I and I put out in Rise of Fire Fellowship before. Oh, yeah. It's fun to check it out. Yeah, it's very good. But anyways, videos of documentaries and stuff like that. No, in that one, exactly. Okay, Rise of Fire Fellowship, the Return of the Judah. The Return of the Judah. It's got a Star Wars intro, but it's basically laying out the future. In how the past has been somehow made out to be the future, and so we're in a suspended
animation.
It's fake. But you know,
we all believe. We all know we're being made believe.
I comfort ones and ones with this saying, so that whatever we just said about the suspended animation not be too burdensome on our souls.
Mm-hmm.
In that he revealed the end from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
So what does that make him, past or present or future?
Forever.
Future for whoever wants to receive him today or tomorrow, perhaps.
Uh-huh.
Then present for those that are in his presence.
Exactly.
And past for those that got left behind.
Exactly.
You know, but to us it's future, present, past. It's one Trinity. It's one Holy Trinity.
And take the gift now. No. Don't wait. Don't expect the credit, like the Gospel of Philip said, because your credit card may expire, and you won't have no credo. You won't have no works nor so, deeds.
What I was gonna say. A brief commentary on the return of the Judah. Mm-hmm. Brief commentary on that. If you listen to when the soldiers, Ethiopian soldiers, warriors, are, because it's tradition to go before the emperor and they get their few seconds of fame, and they start yelling, "Janho, Janho, you know, we're gonna fight for you and we're gonna kill as many Italians." So it's a tradition. He's not only the king of the Christians and of the Jews and of the Muslims, but mm-hmm. he's king of all the tribes and different kinds of cultures mm-hmm, that mm-hmm. that compassed the land of Ethiopia, that form and shape and give life and meaning to Ethiopia. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. A king of many different kings and rulers, but exactly. he's the ultimate messenger from the very God that everybody recognizes to be a God messenger.
Old Testament, New Testament, Apocrypha.
Yeah, all Ethiopia.
The Rastafari, Jah Rastafari, the God of Rastafari.
Most of Ethiopia is not Christian and was not Christian. But all the pagan tribes and all the Jews and Muslims had an agreement that, yeah, but the Christ is the anointed now.
Exactly.
After Judaism turned into Judeo-Christianism by having that lion carry the cross and exactly. being crowned and christened, it became a transfer of power. But anyways, it became...
But for those listening, just in case, and I know your listeners definitely know this, but Christos means, Mashiach means anointed one. Christos is the anointed one in Greek. So just for one.
Yeah, and it's good that you said that, because it gave me a second to think. It's important to say that His Majesty is actually the Mashiach of the unbroken Old Testament line
of Judah
to the New Testament line.
Exactly.
Because Christos Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach, he severed the line from it being a humanity point of view principle. First and foremostly,
exactly.
and elevating it to a spiritual, heavenly thing, in which humanity takes part of, but there's still an element of mysticism, of mystery, in the
exactly.
revelation.
Because, as we ones and ones know, when Christ was born, he was born in that corrupt Herod system that started with the Maccabees.
Everybody was out of line.
Exactly.
Everybody was out of line. People were just
had to be cut, and that's why. That's why I think that's why
dogs being priests, calf
exactly.
being women,
exactly.
bond maidens being children, like everything upside down. Because you have money, you get a priest that's no priest,
exactly.
you make him a Levite, you know?
Exactly.
Corruption.
You don't even have any line, no genetic line at all. But here, what's so great is, and Christ already warned those and those, that sacking of the temple in Jerusalem was the best thing ever, because it destroyed all those records. So it's like, Ethiopia.
And the thing is,
transferred way with Solomon.
Here's the thing about us, stubborn, how stubborn we are. Let's not take it personal, but we are like this. After we've been taking something has been taken away from us, we still act like we still got it.
Mm-hmm.
The power had been transferred to Ethiopia.
Sheba and Solomon time.
But I do dare to say, I'm thinking right
remember
now.
Christ even said his grandmama was going to be pissed. Remember? He kind of slightly said that, like, even the queen of the south. What did he say?
Yeah.
Like, don't make her come down here. That's the real
But here's the thing. Check this out. I don't think I've heard this been said before. Israel had an opportunity, even though the ark had gone to Ethiopia.
Mm-hmm.
God is God. Jah is Jah Almighty.
Yep.
The ark is... Jah give power to an ark. So I'm
blessed.
Saying he could have been, in a way, being in a pause, in a Shabbat time, waiting
you know
to see what Israel was going to react to the Christ.
He was being a gracious father with his old children, with the new children. Like, look.
Yeah.
I married Ethiopia, but you know what, guys? You can keep the house. But you know what? You can stay in the house. And you know how I'm going to make this legal? I'm going to give Gaza to Queen of Sheba. So that then, her unit, this is her territory.
Yeah,
all this is Israel. So in a way, you keep it in the family.
Yeah, because...
But you have the second wife as the executor of the...
Watch. Check out the in your face like reversal move. Like Jah always splits and flips it on everyone, so that no man be found worthy of no honor, and all honor and glory be to Jah that make it all things right.
Tell.
And our wisdom.
Tell the T. Our
wisdom be made foolishness, if we so try to exalt our wisdom above His and not be in His mind. So look at the reversal on this. You're talking about Israel and okay, Israel and Gaza. Okay, Judea was considered the south. The 12 tribes in Samaria were considered the north. When you put Gaza. When you put Gaza into the mix, Gaza is south of
Gaza and the Casa.
Gaza is south of Judea. So what does that make Judea? It makes them north. You're not see. Okay, watch.
You're right.
The land of Israel was divided north and south. In the south was Benjamin allied with Judah, so we have Bethlehem or Beth Ephrata, Ephraim, Benjamin. I'm sure there's something there, but not what I was talking about. The northern tribes were considered the north, and problems came from the north because they were less stuck to Judaism, to Yehudaism,
to being Yehudish. The current contemporary Jewish knowledge, those were the ones who walk even up to China and Russia.
So Judaism pertained to Judea, to the Southland. In scriptures, it's like the South, the good
like
coming from the
from
South.
A New Yorker.
Southerner. And the North has rep of being unfaithful, whatever. But now check this out. You put Gaza, you give Gaza to the Queen of Ethiopia.
Yep.
Now Judah's in the north of Gaza.
Yeah.
Now the Judaism is preserved in the land of the Queen of the South. You were capping on your brothers because they're north of you and you're south?
Yeah.
You want to play that north side, south side?
Exactly.
Now I'm gonna give this land Solomon did give the land of Gaza to the Queen of Sheba.
Basically,
and it's written in the glory of the kings of Ethiopia, which is the Ethiopian King's Chronicles, which is referred to as in its proper title the Kebra Negesht. It's written Solomon gave Gaza as a reward on top of what she had received, even taking her yad, her hand. Sumano, tomo sumano, that's what it says. And they took marriage. They took a different kind of marriage.
There's an
intimacy.
Exchange.
But Menelik was not the only benefit from here. Gaza was given to the Queen of Sheba as well. So now, the reason that's important. You okay?
Okay.
Okay.
Spider.
I apologize for that. You okay?
I'm okay. All
right.
Ugly spider. I'm glad I felt that.
Cool.
On my neck. Now I gotta kill it. No, go ahead. Continue.
All right.
Woo, ciao. Go ahead. I see you.
Spiders, right?
In the country.
So basically, it's like saying, okay, you think you're cool. What I was trying to express is kind of like how Jah is very, very like human-y with us. You guys think it's funny? You like children think it's funny. I'm a flip it on you.
Exactly.
You think you're all bad because you're Southsiders. Well, I'm a bring up your cousin, your family from the South and bring them up, give them some land south of your land. Now who's a Southsider?
Oh yeah, it's kind of like hillbilly.
Who's the queen of the South?
And Beverly Hills.
Listen, the reason it's worthy to mention all this is because hey, let's take it into the Queen of the South. Jesus Christus proclaimed royalty towards the South. You have HaMashiach saying that there is a queen.
Exactly.
You have the elect living child of the living God.
Yep.
Ben HaElohim Hayim. You have him saying that there's a queen. That there's royalty towards the South.
Yes, I continue. This is
okay,
nice.
She's
coming. Just blowing me kisses. I caught you kisses. Got it.
All
right. Yo, I almost caught a spider bite, but continue.
Be kissed by Jah word.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Let your lips be a fountain of living birth continually. I should just add that for the... Listen, I'm going to just add this all randomly. Creation is begotten feminine. The male attribute maybe penetrates into what is already the female presence. So female is everything. It's the presence, it's the house, it's space in itself.
Exactly.
Female. But the penetration of a of us energy, which we're gonna like, I guess.
Continue. Yes.
We're gonna give as a, we're gonna name kind of like pop, no like male.
Mm-hmm. Adam.
Yeah, you could go check that. I'm gonna finish this.
No. I'm just giving dog a sign. All right, continue. Yes, I. So Gaza though. Sorry about the spider, man.
Yeah, I just wanted to just give a word of the lips. Just, you know, for the record, just give the lips of birth. Uh-huh. Birth or creation is feminine in its beginning. It has to begin feminine. And so what I was trying to say is that just like life is born naturally in the flesh through the lips of a righteous woman, bringing forth the righteous man, then it is needful to at least be able to see the misali, the parable, or the likeness of proverb. The likeness and to the image of its creator, of how the mouth of man and woman, if they speak the words that are righteous, if their righteousness in their cause and speak out for the cause that is just, being one, a perfect righteous one, then from the lips of the mouth of even a man bring forth life. And the visual that I'm trying to bring forth is the lips of a woman in her most private part, from where the natural man or woman, whether it be boy or girl, is born. Mm-hmm. But now we're not limited to that kind of birth. We're if we're living beings, that we breed life continually, and from our mouth, when we give true and faithful witness, when we give amen, then our lips become lips that give birth to life, as if from the womb, from the darkness of the throat, cometh forth the light, the life that is manifested in the vibration of word sound, giving power, igniting the horses of those that can receive it. Mm-hmm. Oh, you just touched on something. Oh my gosh. Mm-hmm. You know, that's so true. And you're a igniter. You're a creator.
Even looking, the spirit is moving. My daughter's really good friend, who doesn't live in Oroville any longer, is here for her name is Keturah. So we're talking about the Queen of Sheba.
So Keturah? I think she's mentioned her.
Yeah. And, so well, it's just in living motion and living.
To go forward, because we weren't supposed to talk about the Queen of the South and all this. All even though it has everything to do, because the Queen of the South has been attacked in Ethiopia. That righteous woman that beareth the covenant, beareth from her womb cometh the true testimony.
Exactly.
You know, for. It's Psalm 87. So just a reference as Ethiopia's role and responsibility and bringing forth, protecting up in the highlands in that raised bed garden, protected by the Almighty, kept away from the curiosities of the world, bearing for such a long time now, these 3 days. Oh, here's something about the 3 days. You know how we always seem to be like, okay, from year 2000, the year of the birth of our Lord, our Black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach. You know how we start from zero from thence, 2,000 years?
Uh-huh.
Well, isn't he supposed to rise the third year? It began 1,000 years prior to that in Solomon and Sheba.
Mm.
3 days later, 3,000 years, if a day, as Peter, right. Apostle Peter says, if it is a thousand years in the sight of our Lord, Jesus Christ, then we could say that since Menelik and Sheba is 3 days for the birth of the Son of Man.
Exactly.
Because what came of the Virgin Mary was completely spiritual.
Exactly.
So it didn't even have to be aligned, even though it was, but it didn't have to come with the kingdom like attributes, palace, royalty. Because Jesus Christus is spirit, is royalty and spirit and truth. You know, like.
Exactly.
So he didn't have to pour. I trait that he didn't have to manifest that visually, because he was here to cleanse the inner soul, the royalty and the government gathering, all that. That's future. That's now present to us.
And again, like, I know you're gonna go to D Day, what the Schofield say about the structure day, but like what we were talking about earlier in the car was how Yeshua, you know, based off of some of the Nag Hammadi writings, his testament as a child. You know, being a child of a questionable birth, you know, he just went, it just seemed in those stories, he went through a lot, you know, that with that child that's blamed for everything went through, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, oh, it was Yeshua.
That's
Yeshua,
because
Yeshua.
He's a scapegoat.
Exactly. Salvation.
He's a scapegoat.
Calling on salvation early, and he was angry. I think in some of the Testament, it looked like he had to confront that angry child. We were all an angry child. I remember as a child when I had to make that choice within myself. Am I going to be an angry person, or am I just going to let it go?
Yeah, basically.
So I, you know, just meditating upon that too. So here's that destruction day though, when you can't let it go.
Well, now I'm meditating on Yeshua.
Uh-huh.
See, a lot of things. Let's go forward to destruction day can wait, because here's another thing. Before, remind me to go forward to Yeshua and realizing that everything is for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
The burning bush and the cleansing from within, from without,
mm-hmm.
and his taking on the burden, therefore being female. Rabba. It's Genesis.
Well, you know,
multiplication. To whom more I have given, more they have to bear.
True. And also at the same time, let's look at from a social perspective. Being female, yes, but also understanding the female, because essentially his mother was a single mother. Yo, that's not my kid. That's your kid, Mary. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, the old man, probably Joseph, a little bit older, grumpy, whatever, all set in his, probably the ways of the temple. I mean, I'm sure there were times where he was like, oh, that's your kid. You know, so in a way he could have some overstanding on maybe his mother's plight, the woman's plight, the widow's plight, the widow, the orphan. Anyways.
Well, what I wanted to say, before I go to that, okay, I'm going to remember, but I wanted to say something about why it's okay to go off into a topic. Even though the topic was Destruction Day, D-Day, and we still haven't even begun to get scriptural about it, it's still okay to talk better about life and let this that's going on right now be an edification to all of us to understand that some things, I'm liberal to be able to do all things, but not all things are convenient for me.
Exactly. Like,
and I'm thinking in a you know what, as a memher, as a kind of Rebbe, in a loose sense, you know,
in the spirit.
Yeah. But I'm just saying, like, in a humble way, in the spirit, in position of a teacher,
mm-hmm.
then I begin to think to sacrifice my own selfishness as to all these interesting subject matters that are very interesting. But now I got to think, okay, yeah, they may be interesting, but what am I going to benefit from it?
Exactly.
How are my children?
Is it snack food?
Yeah. How are my children going to receive life from this?
Yeah.
Am I just going to go all ego, and you know, like make myself look cool? Oh, this guy, he knows a lot. You know, big.
Oh, I've got good organic. So, listen, it's like having organic granola bars and healthy food, and going to the health food store and spending $60 when your children are hungry, but you got $60 for the snack food, and it's time for them to eat, dude. Like, yeah.
It's a more efficient way of building.
Mm-hmm.
Setting our eye on the most valuable prize. Talking about Destruction Day, it's interesting and stuff like that, but Jah sent us here to talk about life. So that's why it's important not to get caught up in even destruction. Because now let me testify to something that I was telling Ife, and my nephew, that it's unfortunate to see that the modern day Christian and many other religious folk or superstitious folk, it seems like they got one thing in mind, either complete annihilation,
mm-hmm.
or for some salvation limited to them, because whatever they believe is enough. But see, the emphasis here is not that one is going to be right or the other is going to be wrong. It's the mindset, selfishness.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather not have to see any, like, this attitude that, oh, either I'm saved and they're not because they don't believe the same way. That's not even kosher.
It's not.
That's not even holy.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's kind of like wishing destruction upon others. That's a selfish. Like,
remember,
if we
it's
weren't
almost like killing your brother, like Christ.
Yeah, like if we weren't responsible for half the stuff that happens in the world to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
So carry your cross and don't wish destruction upon others. Now, this other unfortunate circumstance is that a lot of people are just looking towards the end of the world. Oh, when is it going to be? It's going to be the end mm-hmm. of the world, the end mm-hmm. of the world, the end of the world. But nobody ever brings tidings of good, of blessings, of behold, the exactly. conquering lion Yay. Of the tribe of Judah,
yeah.
you know, has risen, has lifted the Christ perfect, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. pure, free from sin, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. glorified, exalted him, mm-hmm. handed the kingdom to him, mm-hmm. that the will in heaven may be done in earth as well. You know, giving all things to the Son, to whom we have been kept in through the Father's name.
Exactly.
So, you know, for life and not for death. All this has happened. Nobody talks about when
you don't want no one to perish.
Basically, to sum that all up, the Bible from beginning to end shows mercy and grace. And a lot of people think that the Torah, the instruction, gives a lot of evil activity, but it's because the interpretation is wrong. Mm-hmm. Because when you see in just sight what you're reading, you're not seeing the punishment. And you're not seeing the brutality of the scripture. You're in the spirit receiving the love, grace, and mercy. Mm-hmm. But you wouldn't be able to see that unless you're in the spirit of love. You could see stoning. We were talking about stoning.
Oh yeah.
This is what I said. Why weren't we able to be more flexible with our literacy, and say, let's stone him, let's cast him with foundation. What's a stone? Mm-hmm. It's a building material that could be cast as a step. Why don't we pile him up with stones of information,
exactly.
of knowledge? Why don't we take him outside of the camp and build him up?
Exactly.
But no, a mind that is condemned to death could only think that, oh, well, Torah is saying go kill him. Mm-hmm. It could mean that. And I'm not saying that an ultimate result of very, very, very uncontrollable rebellion and disobedience, unfortunately, perhaps that's the ultimatum confronted us. Mm-hmm. But as humans, we've been given the ability to reason intelligently as to find alternatives that will bring forth not only correction in the individual, mm-hmm. but will bring forth life, posterity, and that this way works better. You don't kill the person becomes corrected. That's a real correctional facility. Not instigating continual.
Oh, but then here's that rock again that Christ was talking about. On this rock I shall build my foundation.
I shall build, but why die or why exactly. destroy? So what I'm trying to emphasize is that a real Torah spirited individual can see the good and the life and so Torah is so Christly, so loving and so merciful, but it takes one to be in that spirit to be able to recognize it. So now I'm saying, if that's the character of the Bible, let alone the stories of the history of our Black Lord and Savior, mm-hmm. Jesus Christos, and His mercy and grace, then there's no doubt that the Bible from beginning to end is a book of love, grace, mercy, opportunity, chances, mm-hmm. and just blessedness, holiness. Now, having said that, why is the majority of Christian folk focused on the destruction of others? That makes no sense.
Tell it again.
That's a testimony to ones being on the opposite end, then proclaiming themselves to be of light, but there's no light in them.
Exactly.
Otherwise, why would they seek death? If they are life, life would not contaminate itself with death. Mm-hmm. Life would rather instigate the growth of life.
Okay.
Because in life there is no death. Otherwise it would be dead. In life there is growth, progress, and if times may become difficult circumstances that let alone only triumph in the strength that one acquires in knowing that it is of a necessity, not for the destruction of one, but for the increase, for the bringing forth of more fruit and more abundance. It's only a tribulation, a temptation, an uncomfortable moment, but the peace that will result from that is a higher state of being, a higher way of thinking, a higher spirituality, a higher connection with Hashem. So now, with that, I mean, just wanted to point out that I don't see how people are like, yeah, well, the end of the world, when the Bible in a whole is very much about the beginning of life, the beginning of life. Why not receive a good message, Rastafari, bring that good message? You know, so
he even says he's gonna renew the earth.
And this is
the end of the earth. What are they talking about? They didn't see that he's gonna renew it, do a new earth, new heaven. What are you talking about? They want to talk about. They want to renew it themselves.
So you know, now that we long-winded in this, like I just want to make make mention for the record. This is
Logical Español.
Well, you know, I'm gonna introduce Ene Alon Conan Teferi. I haven't used that one in a long time, but Ras Alonso Tafara, the Lion of Judah Society. Sociedad León de la Tribu de Judá, Rastafari en español, that's Sinai, and Ejet Emmanuel Edistin Mariam, Eman Emmanuel, Hermana Emmanuel, Sister Emmanuel, Emmanuel, Saint, Saint Emmanuel Marie.
Exactly.
You want to introduce the ISO?
Yes, Logical Game App, you know, doing it at the well for His Majesty. You know what I'm saying? And Hashem, HaMashiach. So yeah, Logical, just representing Logical Game App, you know, all of our QT Play, Common Unity, Education, Tafari Teaming. You feel it? Yes, I. So yes, I. The T is the AM.
The T root.
So yes, give thanks. So yes, newbie and me also on KRV.
I guess you know what is. It's interesting because I think it's so important to be reminding oneself of this. There's a Genesis, the book of Genesis, chapter 3. You know, I just want to bring this forth because I think it's a very practical, very like instrumental. Instrument that we could make use of every day. It that's what I see from it. So thou sayest, Genesis chapter 3, and the Lord God said to the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. Now I don't want to focus on the serpent, just reading a little bit into to add context. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. Mm-hmm. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. To the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow. It's a mathematical equation.
More children.
If you know Hebrew.
Yeah.
You know that there's an element of being able to. I think they call it the. It doesn't matter what they call it because I'm not too learned in that, but I do know. I do have knowledge of it.
Mm-hmm,
I just don't dance
that's
around
not
focus, in it.
Yeah. That's not your,
but
that's
I do recognize. So now, so just like they interchange, just like they make equal like the letter represented to a number.
Mm-hmm.
Now look at the words themselves as mathematical codes.
Amen.
So when I hear, it says. Greatly, that means already multiplicity.
Mm-hmm.
Multiply, that's twice.
Wow.
Torah don't waste time in mentioning. So basically, it's like saying a positive times a positive.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
It's giving you info that there's something here. Look into it, mm-hmm. and this is going to be like a mathematical equation mm-hmm. to help you out, because this is talking about multiplicity.
Yeah,
it's saying greatly,
not adding.
It's saying greatly multiply.
Exactly.
So if I'm not mistaken, the word in the Hebrew is something to the effect of rabah. Mm-hmm. So it's saying rabah.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's another element added to the word, I'm not learned in the Hebrew to articulate that point. I'm giving the basic root word.
I think we got up to 1,000 in the Hebrew alphabet. So
well,
all the letters.
No,
so.
I'm saying like in this case, like I'm not looking at the number individual numbers.
Yeah.
But looking at the format and looking at it as a rabah, and I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly, kind of. If not, at least that's the Hebrew concordance to the original root word
mm-hmm.
of whatever or however it appears in the original Hebrew texts.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that much. But the just based off the significance of that rabbah, mm-hmm. to multiply and having it twice, it's so coincidental. It's so coincidental.
Mm-hmm.
So now I always remember Rasia Dinos Teferi's words, Rasia Adonis Tefara, Aina Wendom Yadon, and Rebbe. You know, a moment of of Selah for Jah having had gifted, not gifted, you know, let silence be sufficient to declare that this is of tzaddik and of a tzaddik nature, of a righteous individual.
I would say gifted. His father had
gifted this. I was going to say to I and I though. I was going to say like to us, without the Rebbe, you know, Christ would find someone, but the thing is that he manifested in the person of Wendem to I and I, Brother Yadon, Wendem Yadon, to the common individual, Ras Adonis Tafari, Ras Yadino Tefer. So moment of silence for because Sadiq or Sadiq.
And sister
Tehitana. And sister Tehitana. No doubt. So, you know, it's because it's a blessing, and it must be, it's not trying to get on no one's good side, is that when you're in the right mind, you could recognize a right thing, and it's only a right thing to recognize those that have served. Let them serve, but let us be of service. So, you know.
So, a shalom moment.
But, so going forward, in Amen. The spirit, this is what Job put in my mind. To whom more is given, of them more is required. Mm-hmm. So I say it in the spirit, and I don't need to prove this in any other form. You know, I'm not trying to base I and I faith on these verses. Mm-hmm. I and I just trying to edify on this concept of truth. Mm-hmm. I read Rabbah, something to that effect, mm-hmm. and I'm thinking, I'm hearing the whispering of the messengers in the voice of Ras Yadino Seferi say, to whom more is given, more is required. Rabbah, Rabbah. To whom I have given, multiplied, I require a greater amount.
Mm-hmm. Of course, exactly.
So that's kind of like the logic I'm bringing to support the claim that I'm about to make. Okay. It says, to the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply. Mm-hmm. Since I have given you greatly, I'm going to multiply from you what I require.
Exactly.
You kind of see the like transition?
Yeah, kind of like the ungrateful servant, you know, when the master gave
everything's at a price,
and the one who buried his talent.
So what I'm trying to say,
so the women,
is that thy sorrow,
mm-hmm,
and thy conception, mm-hmm. So in thy sorrow to conceive, so what I'm trying to say, if you're a man or if you're a woman, it doesn't matter. If you're feeling the stress of the circumstance, mm-hmm. if you're feeling the stress of the moment, then it is your responsibility to birth life. Mm-hmm. That through sorrow of being the enlightened one in the circumstance, you bear the bringing forth illumination to a way to overcome the circumstance in a Christ way. Mm-hmm. Instead of taking it personal that why do I have to go through this? Mm-hmm. But accept that you are a living sacrifice, and that what your deed will not go noticed. Mm-hmm. You will not be awarded any kind of recognition, earthly recognition, mm-hmm. for being tzaddik, for being righteous. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But the recompense in heavens is far superior to anything we can conceive or imagine on earth. Yeah. So just to motivate or inspire one's inner spirit, or spark the inner spirit of truth, aligned to his very word that governs truth to be, and then not neglecting the manifestation of the prophecy in whatever dispensation of time we happen to be living. Mm-hmm. So just bringing that forth, brothers and sisters, that whoever can bear, if you feel it, that means that it's your responsibility to act maturely about it, because your partner, your spouse, your friend, your girlfriend, your mom may not be in the spiritual capacity to understand what's even going on and move forward in a Christ manner.
And let's be real, and your children. Did you say children?
Children. So to whom, whoever's, and you don't have to be the oldest, mm-hmm. and you don't have to be the parent. It's whoever finds themselves that in the moment you can bear the sorrow, you are bearing, you know, in greatly has been multiplied upon you sorrow in a circumstance. It doesn't have to be a life-threatening event. It could be like a normal decision-making. If you can feel that burden, then it means that through this female experience, should be conceived life. How can we use this moment, instead of getting upset and blaming myself, or why does it have to be me? How, because I can see this, how can I overcome, but but contaminate this not filthily, not with dirt, but contaminate this with posterity of life in the way that I act, so that it could be a set example based on spiritual foundations which once can go forward for endless amounts of generations, saying there was once a time when a righteous woman acted in this way, mm-hmm. acted righteously, mm-hmm. in not burdening her soul but lightening, in that it's a light thing to enlighten the Gentile. Isn't it a light thing? It's not even an effort. If ones just give themselves up completely, you know, kind of like in spirit and in truth, and just be guided by having to carry the cross. And on top of that, yes, we won't go recognized. We won't be put on a pedestal. What for? It makes no difference. Before Hashem, you know, we're named. And that's sufficient. Our name is equivalent to the burden that we must take. Because to lead doesn't mean that you just have a whole bunch of rule over people as to what they're going to do. To lead means to run the course for yourself. And be in your own personal aims, attempting something so far beyond your capacity that in your pursuit after your own vast desire, and it must be in Jah word and guided in spiritual and true foundations which are everlasting for this to work. I mean, that's just protocol. Mm-hmm. But that in trying to achieve the best, you know, living the most exemplary life to the one set by Jesus Christos as example, as the prime choice, the number one declared by the very God through the mouth of man in the person of His Majesty to be the good exemplary character that all men, wherever you be, must do their best to emulate. So in our pursuit of this ultimate goal to be like Christ Himself, HaMashiach, then we would inspire or spark, ignite the will power, the engines within other individuals that might want to follow after you, but not because they have no real responsibility to do so, but because they have been ignited and sparked a passion fuse, you know, towards meaning to their own individual lives, which is what humans need at this point in time. They need to know that they matter and that they're a part of something. And so, and I give thanks to every member of the Lion of Judah Society, whether it be named or not. If we have failed to name each individual member in a, some kind of like professional, you know, roll call sense, then that is to our failure, but also the opportunity of our growth, which is inevitable. And in time, we will have a site mapped system where for sure we'll have an organized mapping out or formation of the actual society in which the name is presented along with the resource that it provides for the, so that we, I'll give one example, like I told Wendem Dawit, over the reasoning on the phone, that we much rather, if the garage is our body, right, and the mm-hmm. garage is full of tools, mm-hmm. you want to have everything sighted out and mapped out so that you don't have to bother a whole day looking for the hammer when all you got to do is go to the map site, exactly. to the formation of the body. Okay, where's the nail? Exactly. Where's the vein system? Who's in charge of the vein system? Who's mm-hmm. pumping blood? Who's blinking? Mm-hmm. Who's mm-hmm. what hair are you? You know, every hair on our heads are accounted for. And so what I'm saying is, we all are still flesh and soulish. And so the soul, it receives a lot, you know, no doubt, through the sense system. So I encourage ones to keep strong in the spirit of wanting to continue in doing or providing for the society. However small it may seem, it's not small at all, because a body works as one. And if even one member is lacking, then the whole composition and formation of the life of this body is jeopardized. And so give thanks and just hope to encourage each individual member, whether, you know, recognized with frequency or throughout extended periods of times or never even mentioned at all. We ask that just patience be rendered in that the end result has been shown from the beginning, so that we may hold on to that very good faith that we've been, that we've inherited, and be one with it, not losing faith in that it'll be made manifest. So if some things take time, it's a trial within itself. If we're loyal, then we're loyal to the very end shown to us from the beginning. You know, rest assured, we will come to be able to, you know, name each one of our members and give ourselves the comfort in knowing that we belong to something, even though we already do. But like I said, we still feed off of the sense system, and seeing it with your eyes and hearing it with someone else's vocalization of the words that represent the understanding of what is being conveyed. You know, without these events taking place, one can begin to become doubtful, because the temptation is always there to become doubtful. But no doubt is that His word is forever, and all things may pass, but His word will last, and those written in it is it's incorporated in the whole system. It's undetachable, it's unremovable, it's one is one. And so let us all recognize each eye to be a different vocalization of a letter within an alphabet, within an alpha tau, or within an alphabet system, you know, for lack of a better expression at this point in time. Let us recognize each one of us a character of this holy language, whether it be Amharic or whether it be Hebrew, but that we form one language, one speech, that in turn is an expression of itself, giving all praise and glory to Jah, Rastafari, Baruch Hashem. Now blessed be the name, but also blessed be the named who have been named with the name of the name. So in one power, since the very beginning, since man can remember, since the Edom even, but since Edamawi, since the beginning, since the ancient, since the east, you know, what comes from the east, the sun. And thus, since man can remember, since the consciousness of man can remember that first power of the Trinity, man unfallen. And so that is that name that we take on, that expresses the fullness of what it is in spirit and in truth, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit under one name, Edamawi Chai Selassie, breathing life into which is already truth. So now, you know, blessed is I and I, Baruch Hashem, Baruch. Blessing to I and I, named, called, and chosen, children of Israel, Rastafari.